Jason Concepcion.
Oh my God, Hall H, wow. You don't understand the amount of years I've tried to get in this room and to be on this side of it. It's a little surreal, so give me a second. Okay, hi, I'm Jason Concepcion. I'm the host of a podcast called X-Ray Vision. I was once the co-host of a podcast called Binge Mode, where we covered every episode of Game of Thrones. I'm so delighted to announce that I am co-hosting the official Game of Thrones podcast, House of the Dragon, with Greta Johnson from the Nerdette podcast. But let's get a little spicy, shall we? Let's add a little fire and blood to our brunch via the extended trailer for House of the Dragon. Please welcome our incredible panelists, Fabien Frankel, Eve Best, Steve Toussaint, Matt Smith, Emma Darcy, Olivia Cooke, Paddy Considine, Millie Alcock, Emily Carey, co-showrunners Ryan Condal, and of course, George R.R. Martin.
It all go out now.
Well, before we get started, Emma has a message.
Oh yeah. Okay, so Miguel Sapochnik, who is co-showrunner with Ryan, got COVID yesterday, so he's not here. But he sent me a text message for you, which I'm gonna read. He says, "Hey Comic-Con, I'm gutted that I can't be there with you today. This is fairly typical for me. The first time I had to catch a plane to Belfast to do Thrones, I forgot my passport. So the fact that the first time I get to come and do Comic-Con with all of you lot for House of the Dragon, I get COVID feels about right. I am deeply honored that so many of you have turned up to show your excitement for House of the Dragon. We've dedicated at least the last 3 years of our lives to making this show, and hope that it is everything you want it to be, plus maybe a little bit that you weren't expecting. And you'll finally get to see what we've been cooking in less than a month. I hope you like dragons." He says, "If I wasn't highly infectious, I'd be dancing in the streets of San Diego with excitement right now. But instead, that duty must fall to our incredible cast." FYI. "This show would not have been possible without their passion, their talent, and their relentless hard work. They have elevated the show to another level, as you'll see. Anyway, enough of me. Fire will rain. Peace out, Meg."
Ryan, George, set the stage for us. What can we expect from House of the Dragon?
Fire and blood.
And dragons.
Yeah. I think the most compelling thing about this particular story, and I think it's the reason that this was the spin-off successor show, as George calls them, that he was most excited about, is because it delves into the history of the Targaryen dynasty. And that's something that we hear about in A Song of Ice and Fire, in the pages of the book, and the original series, Game of Thrones, but we never really get a real sense of it. So this series begins at the absolute pinnacle of the dynasty, the height of power and wealth and influence. They have the most dragons that they'll ever have, and it's just before the bloom starts to come off the ropes.
A quick reminder, keep your bags away from the current. So that
yeah. That's good.
Paddy, yeah, your grace, like that, King Viserys, or King Viserys. How's the throne? Comfortable?
It was lovely, yeah. I couldn't wait to get on it. I got very territorial with that throne, and I wouldn't allow anybody else to sit on it.
That's smart. Why doesn't anybody put pillows on it?
Well, it's part of it is because it's supposed to be uncomfortable to sit on, I think. You know, I didn't have a pillow, by the way. I suffered on that throne. So, but yeah, it's not a comfortable thing. It's made of swords, so you know, it shouldn't be a relaxing experience sitting up there.
What kind of a ruler is King Viserys?
He's a kind man. I think he inherited the crown because he was, in my view, he was a good scholar and a man of good temperament and a kind man who's trying to sort of keep the peacetime going within the kingdom. And I think that's why he was chosen as king. But he's a man who's... what I wanted to do with the character when I read the script was just imbue him with as much humanity as I could. And bring as much kind of life to him as I possibly could. But he's a man that cares about things. There's great tragedy in him. He loves his family, he cares about his position. But he's also carrying something else that's a kind of secret that's revealed in the show that, kind of refers to the potential fall of man in the future. So there's lots of different things going on.
Speaking of that family, Matt, our Daemon Targaryen, what's that relationship like, that brother relationship like?
With his brother?
Yeah, go on, give it him.
It's complicated. I mean, that was the sort of heartbeat for me, really, and I had such a fabulous time with Paddy. It's quite a complicated relationship, but I sort of hope that me and Paddy found a lot of depth and a lot of richness in the work that we did. But really, everything is about his brother for Daemon. Mm. Yeah.
Eve, Rhaenys, the queen that never was. What does that moniker mean to her?
Sorry, could you repeat the question?
Oh, sure. the queen that never was.
Yeah.
What does that mean? What does that mean to Rhaenys?
What does the title mean to
her? How does she relate to?
It really pisses her off, I think. She should have been the queen. And I was, yeah, thank you very much. And it's kind of annoying that she isn't. And it's also kind of annoying that people keep remembering and reminding her that she isn't. So, yeah, that's what I have to say about that. Thank you!
Steve, our Corliss Valerian, part of Rhaenys's family, tell us about that badass sailor adventurer that is Corliss.
Well, I could talk for hours about that, but I'll spare you that. So basically, he is a famed nautical man. He did his first solo voyage, I think, in his teens. He built his first ship called the Sea Snake at the age of about 20, 21. And he went on these famed 9 voyages, which is the basis of the fortune that he has amassed when we meet him in this series. So. At the time that we meet them, he's an extremely wealthy man in this land, and that's through his adventures. He's a self-made man.
Fabien, our man from Dorne.
You people appreciate his hard work, thank you.
Fabien, our man from Dorne, a vibrant fighter. How's the swordplay going?
Better than when I started. Our first rehearsal with Matt, I smashed him in the face with a sword, and I thought it was going to get fired pretty quickly.
It did.
Yeah, it did.
It scarred me.
So yeah, I know. Getting better.
Yeah. Emma, Rhaenyra, what drives her? What drives Rhaenyra?
Fire. I think Rhaenyra is fueled by that old Targaryen stuff. And I think probably the journey she goes on in the series is one of working out when to let that fire burn and when to dampen it.
George, what's it like seeing these characters come to life from this part of Westeros' history, second century of the Targaryen?
Yeah, it's pretty exciting. For sure, he's nervous at the beginning because these books, these characters are like my kids. And when you give your kid to people for adoption, you wonder how they will be treated. Will they be, will you recognize them when they come back to you and all that? But I've been very, very fortunate here. I think Ryan has done a great job of adapting the book so far.
Thank you.
And our cast here is amazing. I haven't had a chance to meet them, unfortunately. With COVID, I didn't get to visit the set and hang around as I did on a certain other show in the past. I've seen 9 of the 10 episodes, and it's pretty amazing. Pretty amazing. I'm really very happy.
Ryan, you mentioned all those dragons. We can't wait to see the dragons. We love the dragons. How did you make them have their own personalities? How did you differentiate them from each other?
Well, that was really important for the show because there are 17 of them. Oof. at the height of this. So it was really important to, as you said, differentiate them not only in the way they looked, but the way they behaved and acted and the way they bonded with the riders. And Miguel and I think that was one of the earliest things that we started concepting on. This is probably about a year before we started filming. And it was a very organic process. We worked with a couple of conceptual designers just went through this very iterative process. And of course, George, who writes very detailed books, gave us the gift of specifying color and size and age. So we really took all of those things that are given to us in the book and then tried to extrapolate them and add personalities to them. Like Caraxes is very cantankerous and agitated, and he's always moving and flexing. He never sits still, much like his rider. We built out from Cyrax and Caraxes and Vhagar, the biggest dragon certainly alive right now, Behemoth, and then went on to the second tier, the third tier dragons, and we've designed dragons that you won't even see yet in season one because we're having such a great time with the designers. So I'm very excited to show. You've seen some teases in the trailer, but there's much yet to come, and I think you guys will like it a lot.
For our group, was there a moment when you felt like, maybe it's when you first got in costume or you first got a sword in your hand or something, when you felt like, oh, I think I'm beginning to understand this character. I think I've got it.
The wig.
The wigs.
Yeah. It was all the wig. It's like a Targaryen rite of passage, maybe. I felt like that was the first time I realized that I was actually going to do this show. The wig does all the work.
Any favorite dragons?
Caraxes. Caraxes is the best dragon.
Maelys. Maelys.
He is the best dragon.
Maelys is the best dragon. He's the most handsome. Most wonderful flyer, the most beautiful.
Since this story is so much about succession, I wonder if you thought about, if you personally ruled, not your character, if you personally ruled, what would your first decree be?
I'd allow them to dye their hair. So I don't have to get in the wig. It takes an hour and a half. It's, it looks great. It's a pain in the ass to put on.
Pants for the ladies. Going to a toilet in a portaloo on the top of a mountain in so many skirts and tights and thermals, you were just covered in shit. It's awful. Not shit, but mud.
You heard it here first, folks. For our Rhaenyras and our Allisons, Millie and Emily, and Emma, Emily and Olivia, what was it like playing characters at two different stages of life? How did you work it out or not work it out? How did you build that character?
We didn't.
Yeah. We've never met.
We've met three, four times. Yeah. A handful of times. So that was kind of weird, being like, oh, I play you, never met you. I don't know.
Yeah, I think I feel like maybe I had the easier job, and that I was thinking about when you see photos of yourself as a child or like camcorder footage, and that person's really familiar, but they're also quite distinct from who you are today. And I felt that so hard when I saw episode one, and I saw you, and it was like watching like Targaryen home video or something. Like that.
Yeah,
like that is not. I'm somewhere else now, but like I know you. It was lovely. Yeah.
Has anybody thought about, again, so much about succession is what drives this drama. What's the best, the ideal ruler for Westeros would have what kind of traits?
What do you think, Ken?
George?
Well, I think one of the fundamental things is in a good king is someone who regards being king as a duty rather than a privilege that they are entitled to.
Or queen.
And they have a duty to the realm to dispense justice, to have peace, and occasionally to do boring things like building roads and sanitation in King's Landing and all that. Nobody really wants to do a spin-off show about King Jaehaerys builds the roads. but I do think if you actually lived in Westeros, you might like a king who's more concerned with building roads than fighting wars. And Viserys, of course, who comes to the throne when the old king dies, that's sort of his goals too. I mean, he does kind of at the end of his life. He wants a little glory, but he's not driven by glory. He wants to be a good king, a wise king, to protect his people. I think those are the most important traits.
Yeah, I really love the way that Paddy embodied King Viserys, because I think in the reading of the book, you can get this impression that he's passive and he's a people pleaser and he's just trying to keep the peace all the time. And he is, but I think the thing that Paddy brought to Viserys was this real inner fire and his passion for being a people pleaser and trying to keep everybody united and fighting to do so, knowing that we're sitting at the top of the heap here, and if I let order break apart, war will follow, and it's my duty to not let that happen. So he fiercely tries to keep everybody together, but it's Game of Thrones, so everybody has their own political agendas and desires for power and strength and influence. And I actually think, I think Viserys, Paddy's Viserys in particular, is a very modern ruler that is a bit of an anathema in a medieval period like this that respects might and strength and masculinity. What Viserys does and is remembered for, I think, is not necessarily in line with the way he attempted to rule his kingdom.
Emma brings up a great point. Why not a queen? When Aegon invaded, 66% of the dragon pilots were female. What is it, George, Ryan, or anyone, what is it about Westeros that they're just so anti a queen?
Yeah, great question.
I'd like to know.
You know, I my books are fantasies, obviously, but I do follow history a lot. I get inspiration from history, and then I take elements from history and I turn it up to 11, obligatory Spinal Tap reference, or to 111. Game of Thrones, as many people observed, was based very loosely on the Wars of the Roses. This show was based on an earlier period of English history called the Anarchy. And, I pilfered freely from real history. When Henry I, the King of England, when his only legitimate son drowned while trying to cross the English Channel, he was left with only one legitimate child, which was his daughter Matilda, and he named her his heir, and he made all the lords of the kingdom swear their fealty to her. And then some years later he died, and most of the lords of the kingdom forgot about that oath or said, no, it doesn't apply. Because here comes her cousin, Stephen, who crosses the channel quickly and steals the treasury and gets himself crowned king. And you entered the period called the Anarchy, where Maud or Matilda, as she was known, and Stephen fought for a decade, 2 decades, whatever, yeah.
Horrible and bloody.
Yes, all the good stuff. None of the building roads, peaceful things. So that was the inspiration there. I don't think Westeros is particularly more anti-woman or more misogynistic than real life and what we call history.
Yeah.
People fear change.
Mm. I mean, we also haven't fixed it, right? Like, we still choose male rulers. Like, it's 2022, and we tend to pick men. And I think one of the questions of the series is, if you are a woman looking to rule, how do you convince male subjects that you're not other? Like, that is, that's kind of a question. I don't know it has an answer. We don't have an answer, but today.
The blood of old Valyria is well represented up here. How's everyone's High Valyrian? Can we order lunch? Can we?
Millie can.
No,
Millie's excellent at it.
Millie's
the best.
I can only order a cappuccino.
I don't know. I only know what I said in the scene of how to say in High Valyrian. Even then, I don't even know what I'm saying. But it was fun. I mean, me and Matt had a lot of High Valyrian scenes together.
A lot.
Which was fun. Did anybody else speak? Paddy?
I had one line.
Yeah.
I think it's been caught. Let me try and remember it. It's something like Scorki dosos adrizo dromon tom epsa unerati la dixon cortas.
Obviously, the shoot can be super intensive, but how did you guys have fun on set? How did you blow off some steam? Boxing, darts, trivia night?
I wish. That's going to be in the rider next season, but if there is a next season, I don't know. There was a chocolate table that Rhys would flirt with up until 5 p.m., and then he'd just ravage the whole entire table. Rhys plays Otto Hightower, and he isn't here today, which is upsetting, but he's great.
He also had like an amazing way of eating crisps where he would sort of like finger the bag and really kind of, and then it would spill everywhere, all over, and then he would run off and be like, well, there's a massive mess here, I don't understand where this comes from.
Also, the joys of watching him take the absolute piss out of Fabien. I could see like cogs turning in Rhys's head as he's looking at Fabien, and then he'll just be like, Fabien, ever thought about playing a teenage werewolf? And it was just, and then you'd be teen wolf for 3 weeks until it was something else.
Yeah, he started a lot of rumors on the set, most of which I don't think I should share.
This is a world that is famed for its iconography. The Valyrian steel swords, dragon eggs, the Iron Throne. Any particular favorite prop? And I ask because if you can steal it from me, that would be super great. But any favorite props, any favorite item from the world?
My knife. It's a very important knife.
My knife. Mm-hmm.
What? Yeah, my knife. I wanted to keep it. But, you know, they're very hot on that on the show, so they wouldn't let me take a knife. And, trying to nick one was hard as well, so, yeah, that was the thing for me. I quite liked having a knife. I thought they'd give it me at the end, HBO. You know, I was a good king after all. If there's anyone listening out there, give me the fucking knife.
HBO, please give him the knife.
Sorry,
Brian here is actually Kleck's movie and television props. He has a wonderful podcast.
I do.
What Dreams Are Made Of.
Yes.
So I expect at the end of the show you'll make off with all the really good props.
I'm going to get a knife for Paddy.
Thank you, Ryan.
Yeah.
Thank you, brother.
Make it happen.
great plug for Ryan's podcast.
Thank you, by the way, George.
Ryan, as a prop connoisseur, anything that you were really geeked out about to see?
All of it. Yeah, it was all. Everything was great because it's a wonderful kind of show for that because everything has to be custom made. You can't really buy stuff off the shelf. All the costumes are bespoke. All the weapons are custom made for the show. Everything, banners. So it's just a feast
but
for the eyes.
Are the severed heads going to be custom made, or can you get a box of severed heads like we did with Game of Thrones?
We have a specific budget line item in season 2 for custom severed heads.
Ah, very good. So.
I did nick something.
What did you? Oh,
I would never tell you what it was because no one's known it's gone missing. But I did steal something. Come after me.
Erase this tape. Erase this tape. For our group, how much of family is so important to this story? Did you lean on any of your own family history to try and find the drama here, or is it just all on the page for you?
I'm pretty much on the page. I mean, my family history doesn't involve murder, rape, and incest, as far as I know. I think for the most part it was what's on the page and then trying to equate the value you have for your relationship into the character's value for his or her relationship, I think. That's kind of how I approach it anyway.
Are you a sailing man now, Steve?
No, I actually get seasick, which is, doesn't augur well, but no, I don't. But I was kind of jealous because my whole family all get to ride dragons and I don't. Which is
I don't ride a dragon.
Someone here loves me. Thank you. Yeah. Ah, indeed. There you go. I'll survive.
Jason.
Yes.
Emily Carey impressed both Miguel and I really out of our seats on one of her first days on set because she does journaling in character as a way of learning her background. Emily, you should talk about that because it's fascinating.
Yeah, so I find it one of the best ways to like get into character. And for Alison, we had so much creative freedom, like all of us as a group, including Millie and Rhys as well, to sort of make up this whole backstory to her. Obviously, when we find Alison, she doesn't have a mother. And there was some gaps that we had to fill. And so to sort of figure it all out, I just started journaling, and with the advice of Miguel and Ryan, I managed to come up with some form of backstory, and it proved to be very, very useful. So I think that ties into the family thing as well, is that there's a lot of Alison's family that you don't see, but for the relationship between Alison and Otto, family is such a key word, because it's all about bloodline. I mean, that's kind of what the show's all about. So.
Is there anything you could share that you found through that process?
I think it just gave me a deeper understanding of Alison. I think she's so multifaceted. There's so many layers to her. I think lots of people are expecting her to be the villain of the show already, but I think bringing her in younger, there was a lot more to explore. I think we were saying earlier as well that we didn't really talk to our older counterparts because there's such a huge character progression for both Alison and Rhaenyra. I've never had the freedom to be able to create a whole human being like this before. So it was so much fun being able to go so in depth with her.
We heard a lot about the... Is there even such a thing as a hero and a villain in this story for our group?
Well, it depends on how you define those terms. We're not going to have, you know, anyone who's called Lord Evil or Mr. Atrocity or anything like that. And we don't have orcs or Trollocs or you know, any like that. But they're certainly evil. I always believed in the most interesting characters are great characters, like all the human beings I've ever met and read about who are capable of generosity and love and doing good, and then the next week they do something selfish and bad, and you know, we all have things to be proud of, we all have things to be ashamed of, and that, to my mind, you know, I'll quote once again William Faulkner, who in his Nobel Prize acceptance speech said, the only thing that's worth writing about is the human heart in conflict with itself, and that's something I've always taken as a mantra here, that all of these characters, have good in them, have evil in them, and it's a matter of what choices they make. And I like the fact that the readers of Fire and Blood divided as to who actually is the hero and who actually is the villain. And I hope the viewers of the show will have the same issues here. We probably should have seated this audience with greens on one side and blacks on the other.
We're not there yet, George.
Okay.
we're very united right now. The crowd is very united. Everybody is very happy. We don't want a war within the audience.
So we'll do that next year.
Yes.
Right. Okay. What's it like to ride a dragon? I'm sure a lot of us have imagined it in this room. For our dragon riders, what's that experience like?
The only dragon I have ever ridden in my life is... the one from the never-ending story.
Betray you.
Yeah, him. Because I don't ride a dragon in the show. But I was in the film studios in Germany, and there was something that looked like a bunker, and it was really run down, and these school kids kept going in and out of it, and I was like, well, they keep, what's in there, you know? So when everybody went, I tried the door, and it opened, and I walked in, and there he was. Like, in this room with all damp and everything, he was like... So I was like, oh, it was just me and him, so I got on the back and had a little ride, like, yeah. That's the only dragon I've ever ridden.
True story. Can't be right.
For our, if...
On a proper...
Any other dragon riders? Any other experiences of riding dragons? Gosh, I'd love to do it. But it seems like a lot of upkeep.
It's kind of weird, like... I'm gonna paint you a picture. We worked on a volume stage, which is basically the size of this whole hall, and it's all LED screens, and you're propped up on what looks to be a mechanical bull that you might ride at like a bar or a pub, and they harness you in, and then you're just lifted like 6 feet off the ground, and there's just like four guys with leaf blowers. And you've just got to like do it. I mean, it's strange. Yeah.
But it also feels weirdly alive. I don't know how.
I know. That's what's weird about it.
Because it makes these noises, so it goes when it's moving, and it's moving, and you. It's weird, isn't it? It feels like it's a live thing. Is that just me?
No, I agree.
You also have to act opposite these dragons. It's like a man holding a tennis ball on a stick, and then like another dude blowing, and then like the director will be like, okay, so now you're getting attacked by the dragon, and you have to like scream at this tennis ball, and it's really hard to keep a straight face when you're doing that. But I did, I promise.
He did a good job.
Ryan, I'm sorry to ask you this again, but I think it's such an incredible story, and one I think probably many people in this room have imagined, is how you, your relationship with George started.
I refer to it as a bit of light fan stalking. My very first television pilot was a supernatural western that NBC had picked up to go shoot. And we selected, by chance, the filming location of Santa Fe, New Mexico. And I said, well, I don't know anything about Santa Fe, New Mexico, but I know one person who lives there. And I was gonna be there for many months, and I said to my agents, knowing that they also represented George, hey, can I buy him dinner while I'm out there and just talk to him and pick his brain. And this was 9 years ago. And I don't know why, but George said yes and let me buy him dinner and sweat profusely in front of him. And I talked a lot about his books and how much I was influenced by him as a writer. And I just really wanted to just get to know him and pick his brain a bit. And then he came and visited set. And hung out on our western, And everybody kept asking me, do you know George R.R. Martin? And I said, I guess I do now. And we stayed in touch. And he came to LA fairly often to win Emmys. So he would always look me up in September when he was in town. And one day he called me and I came out to have a beer with him and he offered me a job. And here we are 4 years later. And it's mental. It's really, it's crazy.
Wow.
Brian may have been picking my brain when I visited the set, but I was stealing his cast. We did two of the people on that busted pilot were later hired by Game of Thrones.
That's right. Yeah. The great Pedro Pascal was was a Pinkerton detective, kind of bumbling Pinkerton detective in our pilot, and also the great Mikael Huseman was the star of the show. He played Drake Sinclair, the rogue gunman.
And later went on to be our second Dario Naharis.
That's right. Infuriatingly handsome.
We're about a month out now, and here we are at Comic-Con, Hall H. Candidly, I'm freaking out. How is everybody feeling? How is everybody feeling right now?
Ew.
Knowing that the show is looming.
Ew. You know, there's this behemoth that we're following in its footsteps, and there's a massive pressure that we feel, to give you guys what you want, but also make it different, and to also put our own stamp on it. And we're so grateful for what came before, which was so amazing. And we just hope that this has the same legacy, because God, we worked our bums off for a year, and you know, these guys worked for longer, and yeah, man, I just hope it, I hope you like it.
Steve, I asked you this yesterday, and I have to ask you again. As a fan of color, as an Asian fan, it's delightful to see you here. What is it like to be here? It feels great to see you in this role.
Thank you. It does feel great because other than, as we spoke about yesterday, other than certain people's viewpoints about someone who looks like me playing this part, it hasn't really played a part in the role, in my experience on the job with my fellow actors. As I said, there are people outside who find it a little hard to stomach that someone who looks like me would play this part, but that's an issue they have to deal with, and I don't have to. You know, so I just have to, the issue is always the same. I just have to say the lines convincingly and avoid bumping into the furniture. So, as I do that.
Any other thoughts? Any other stray thoughts bumping around in anyone's head?
I got arrested.
Don't ask that of this class.
Paddy, Steve told me you can box.
I can't box. No, don't start that one.
But you know how to throw a punch properly.
Well, yeah, possibly, yeah. I've been taught how to throw a punch properly. That doesn't make me a boxer at all.
Are you challenging him?
I mean, what's going on? No, definitely not. 100%. I think I could take The Rock, who is back there.
Yeah, I'll give him a good hiding.
Yeah.
Old school style. On the cobbles.
If you had
like the Gypsy King himself.
if you had to fight one Sir Criston Cole or 100 baby dragons, everyone here, which would you choose?
I'd beat the shit out of all of them.
Is it time for fan questions yet?
Yeah.
Now, I would add for our fans who are going to ask questions, this is the big shot. Don't throw it away. If you've read the books, don't ask a question like, hey, when so-and-so meets so-and-so, is so-and-so gonna happen? If you haven't read them, don't ask what's gonna happen. Don't, this is a great opportunity for the peeps.
Hi, everyone.
Hi, what's your name?
My name's Luke. Matt, guess what? It's Lorbid time. All right.
It's what?
You starred in a movie recently called Morbius, which is great.
Oh yeah, oh yeah. Right.
All right, my
I was said with deep irony, was it?
All right, I gotta get to my question. My question for you is, how would your character in Morbius fit well into the Game of Thrones universe?
Well, I mean, he's a vampire, so I think he'd struggle first off. I don't know, really. How would he fit well into the Game of Thrones universe? That's a very good question. I think he would be a fish out of water, in truth. I don't think he's got the chops to do it. But I'm glad you watched a completely different movie. To- Oh, the Doctor would be all right, mate, yeah. He'd land on his feet.
Next, your name?
My name is Tori, and my question is for Eve.
Is that Rhaenys?
It is.
Hello.
Oh my god, you look amazing.
That's amazing.
Thank you.
You look so much better than I do.
You definitely look much better.
Oh my god.
So the hair's even better, isn't it?
Yeah, everything. Is that the wedding? You come as the wedding?
Yeah.
Oh my god, I love it.
That's incredible.
So you come from a theater background where you played many famous characters from text. What drew you to Rhaenys, and how does it feel to be joining a universe with such another famous character from text?
I'm so sorry, can I just ask you to ask me that a little bit slower? Because I didn't quite hear.
Of course. So you come from a theater background where you've played many famous characters from text.
Yeah.
What drew you to playing Rhaenys, and how does it feel to be joining another universe with such a famous character from text?
It is an amazing thing, an amazing creature that I didn't know anything about the Game of Thrones. Before I joined the show, but I hadn't seen it, but I knew that it was this amazing deal. And I was very, very intrigued to learn more about it. And I, when I met Ryan and Miguel, they were really cool. And I thought what they had written was very cool. We didn't have any information in the script that we were sent. All the names were changed, and they told us, "Oh, this isn't the real script." And the whole thing was really mysterious. So I didn't really know exactly what it was, this thing, but my agent just kept saying, "It's a really amazing, extraordinary world, and it's an extraordinary show, and it was wonderful writing." And then they were really amazing people, and I thought, gosh, I'd like to be part of this. And I'm really happy that I am.
Next, your name.
Hello, my name is Stefana, and my question is for Matt Smith.
Hi, Stefana.
Hi. So nice to meet you.
It's very nice to meet you, too.
So, I grew up seeing you as a good guy, as the 11th Doctor.
Yeah.
How does it feel to take on more sinister roles, like in Last Night in Soho and now this?
Well, I think it's just quite good to sort of have breath as an actor, and you sort of try and challenge yourself and find different avenues to play, really. And once I sort of played the Doctor, I was quite actively looking to sort of do something that felt completely different. So yeah, it was really nice to meet you. Have a great Comic-Con.
Yes.
Hi, my name is Ron, and my question is for Mr. George R. Martin. Will we see you in a cameo?
Will you see me
in a cameo?
I don't know.
Please.
I mean, for the last couple years since COVID hit, I've hardly left my house. I've been, you know, trying to stay away from COVID and also, you may not know, but there's this book that I'm writing. It's a little late. And I don't see me visiting a set or doing anything until I finish and deliver that book. And then if the show's still going, who knows, maybe I'll show up. I did do a cameo in the original pilot of Game of Thrones, but that they reshot most of the pilot, so I was left on the cutting room floor. And I was supposed to be, at a certain point, I was supposed to be a severed head. You know, that scene where Joffrey makes Sansa look at all the severed heads on the walls, I was gonna be one of them, but then they found out how expensive it was to make a severed head, and they just bought a box of used severed heads. One of whom was George W. Bush, which got us in a lot of trouble when people noticed it. And I don't think he's there any longer, but if you get one of the old DVDs, you can see that. But I know, who knows, maybe I can yet become a severed head at some point.
George, I know a guy. I think I can get in the show. You're welcome anytime.
George, thanks so much for leaving your home to be with us here today. Yes.
Oh, my name is Will. My question goes to George R. Martin. What was the most difficult piece of, say, this story that was hard to adapt onto this show that you feel comfortable discussing?
Well, it is a very hard story to adapt because it's very long and it's very complicated and there are many, many characters in it. And so, you know, Ryan had quite a challenge there in adapting it. I don't know, what was the hardest part to adapt?
I mean, that's a great question. It's a really interesting challenge because it is not a traditional novel. It's not written in prose. It's a history book, as George calls it, a fake history. And so there's a lot of signposts in it, but there aren't necessary. There's some dialogue, but then other things. It's just, oh, this happened on this day, and then there was a war, or there was a fight. So the trick is, I think, painting in the lines that you have point A and point C, but you don't really know what point B was, and that's the fun of the invention of the show. But I, to me, the most challenging thing is just the sheer amount of time that the story covers. Because it's the story of a generational war, so it was figuring out how to structure it in such a way that we could move people through this very complex timeline in a very simple way so that people didn't get lost. And I think we've done a pretty good job, but that was certainly a brain bender for the writers and I. And thank you, Sarah Hess, who's somewhere in the audience, for saving our bacon on that.
The challenge with anything as big as Fire and Blood or the Game of Thrones and its sequels before that is there's always this tendency to simplify. Oh, there are too many characters. And somebody, when Game of Thrones first came out, some of the reviews were people who were professional television reviewers. So many characters, I couldn't keep track of them, you know. But people did learn to keep track of them. I don't want to underestimate the intelligence of the audience or the readers. You can keep track of them. You don't have to combine characters and eliminate characters. The audience is more sophisticated than sometimes people making television assume. And that's one of the great things about working for HBO is that they're willing to tackle things that are a little more challenging than you would get the over-the-air networks or some other things.
Hi.
Hey. My name's Raphael. Pleasure to be with you all. My question is, what realms in Westeros that we're just a little bit familiar with from the previous work are we really going to get to dive in and get to know?
Oh, realms.
Realms, geographies. Oh, and one quick comment.
He was going to tell us that we were great.
Driftmark.
Drifted. I mean, there's a lot of King's Landing. There's a lot of Dragonstone in the show. There's a lot of other places too that we have visited before and haven't seen yet. But I think Driftmark, which is the home of House Velaryon, the great sea snake, and his family, is a new world that we explore quite a bit.
Yes, I see the hoary old dragon. Valerian the Black Dread, waiting to ask a question.
Yeah.
That's amazing.
Yeah, so wonderful, looks great.
Hey, I'm Sari. My question is for anybody who wants to answer. So the sigil of the House Targaryen is a dragon. If you yourselves had a house, what animal or symbol would you pick for it?
I'd pick a llama.
My sigil is the turtle, that's why I wear one on my hat here, so.
Emma, go on.
A Wolverine.
Yeah. No, maybe.
A badger or something. Oh, yeah.
Just some I'd have a lion.
I can, like, a fox.
Yeah, you're a fox.
Yeah, thank you.
Okay. I said turtle, but I kind of take it back now.
I had a lot of fun writing the books with the heraldry. I get carried away with the heraldry for the houses. You know, I read about, when I was starting, a lot about actual medieval heraldry and all that, which is fascinating, but also kind of boring, because it's like 75% of the people have lions and the others all have eagles. And, you know, where are the badgers and the... you know, the lumps of coal. Kristen Cole has, I think you have 9 lumps of coal on your shield, right?
Yes.
Yes, not really as exciting as a Wolverine, but yeah. Still.
I'll take it.
Yes, next. Hello, I'm Nico Holt. Will we get a chance to see the house history of Targaryens through these series of for the show?
I mean, that's what the show is about. So I have good news for you.
The thing about history, of course, is it's, you know, just one damn thing after another, as someone said.
That's right.
So we're showing the history of House Targaryen at a certain point in time, but you can go before that. Fire and Blood actually begins with Aegon's conquest, so there are like 4 previous generations. And Aegon wasn't born from sea foam. He also had a father and a mother and a grandfather, and they're all the lords of Targaryens that go back to when they escaped the Doom of Valyria. But you can go back further, and what were they up to in the Doom of Valyria? And who knows, maybe if I can only live to be 140 instead of 73, maybe I'll write some of those other stories about the Valyrians in the past. But there's a lot of history.
Well, thank you so much, Hall H. I'm sorry we don't have more time for questions. I'm sorry.
Let him go.
Let him ask his question.
Yeah. Okay, go. Get in.
Hello, the guys, all the guys. Great. British can do. They'll let me back there. So, yeah, quick question.
The name,
sorry, because I can't ask the original one. I'm guessing you've learned from the mistakes of the series. Have you banned coffee cups from the set?
Banned coffee cups.
Coffee cups.
No.
Okay,
they're everywhere.
Hall H, thank you so much. Everyone here, can't wait for you to watch the series, August 21st. Thank you so much, this has been amazing.